I'm very glad to be with you tonight. It's the book, as you can see, the picture up there, was a project that developed quite by accident. I didn't set out to write a book about the New Jersey Militia. As I was explaining to one person beforehand, I have no New Jersey ancestry. I'm first generation New Jersey. My ancestry in the Revolution period is New York State and New England. So why did I get interested in a militia regiment in New Jersey? If any of you know Hopewell Township in Mercer County, there's a Mercer County park called Howell Living History Farm. And Howell Living History Farm portrays farming as it was around 1900. So we use horsepower for farming and oxen sometimes, mostly horsepower. And one of our horses was used by a Revolutionary War reenactment group to pull their cannon for the reenactment of the Battle of Monmouth and some other events. So they wanted to do a program for us. Well, it's hard to do a Revolutionary War program on a farm that's, you know, 1900. So not quite the right mesh. So the farm director turned to me and said, Larry, if you can find out what was going on in the Revolution in the valley where this farm is, in Hopewell Township, and if the reenactors will help our visitors understand that, then we'll do the program. But we won't just do a generic Revolutionary War program. The one thing I knew was that the man who owned that farm in the 1770s was a captain in the local militia regiment, the 1st Hunterdon County Regiment. It's now in Mercer County, but it was Hunterdon County back at the Revolution. And so I said, okay, I got to find out what the militia was all about, and I got to find out what they were doing and what his company was doing. And I found out that that's almost impossible because nobody's ever written about it. So I started doing some research at the New Jersey State Archives, at the David Library, the American Revolution, and some other places, and began to put together a story of the New Jersey Militia, and particularly this regiment, that I finally started saying to myself, this is so good and so different, and something that's not been done before, maybe I ought to do a book about it. And the people who were helping me research at the archives and the David Library said, yeah, do one. We get questions about the militia all the time. We don't have anything to show people. So with all of that support and about 6 years of work, and I finally came out with a book that started out to be the background for a Saturday program with Howell Farm. It just kind of got carried away. So that's the kind of story behind it. What I'm going to talk about tonight is how militia service during the Revolution affected not only the men who were in it, but also their families. And it was a family commitment, if you will, and you'll see why as we go along. The title of the book, A People Harassed and Exhausted, is a quote George Washington. In 1778, Washington was having trouble getting the militia men to turn out. Rather small numbers of men who were supposed to be coming out on duty were coming out. And everybody was complaining about it. And Washington finally just said in one of his responses, it's no wonder there are people harassed and exhausted. And who'd been harassing and exhausting them? He had. He'd been asking them to do more than they were really ever intended to do. And we'll see exactly why that was as we go along. So he was describing the effects of militia duty on the family, not just the militiamen, when he made that statement. I also wrote a chapter for a book published recently on New Jersey and the Revolution, and I entitled that chapter, A Disproportionate Burden on the Willing. And that's a quote also from Governor William Livingston, the governor of New Jersey during the Revolution. And Governor Livingston was angry throughout. He kept getting reelected every year, starting in 1776. It was a one-year term, but he was constantly governor during the Revolution. And he did nothing but moan and groan about how bad the militia law was and allowed so many men not to serve in the militia that only those who were truly willing to serve really had to or really did serve. And they had to carry the burden for everybody, even though a lot of people avoided militia service. So we've got two questions really to look at here. The first one is, why were the militia called out so often that they were harassed and exhausted? That's question number one. Question number two, obviously, is how did that law work that was so bad? One of the things that a lot of people in New Jersey don't appreciate or don't understand is just how much of the Revolution was fought. Very literally, there were more battles and skirmishes, there were more encounters between the Patriots and the British, or Loyalists, or Hessians, than in any other state. It's in the hundreds of encounters. We know a few major ones, like the Battle of Trenton, the Battle of Princeton, Battle of Monmouth, Battle of Springfield, Connecticut Farms, Short Hills, and some of those are pretty close to here. But we don't know about all the day-to-day stuff that was going on. And one of the reasons New Jersey had so much activity was because of the British making a headquarters, if you will, at New York, and having an army on Staten Island, Long Island, Manhattan Island, from July of 1776 until November of 1783. Virtually the entire war, from about 1 month after the Declaration of Independence until the end of the war, when the British went back to Britain and put the army out. They were there in New York. What separates New York from New Jersey, particularly Staten Island? The Arthur Kill. It's not very much. And what did those British soldiers on Staten Island and Long Island need? They needed a heck of a lot of food, because there were many thousands of them. It was a big army. They had horses. Horses needed food, as well as the men did. They were constantly coming across into northern New Jersey, into this area where we are right now, and foraging for food. And the militia in New Jersey wound up being a primary group to try to stop that foraging. So even a militiaman where I live, outside of Trenton, those militiamen were going all the way across New Jersey to counteract the British forays from Staten Island. That was about a three-day walk, because it was a walk, okay? And it was a three-day walk back. And because the British were there about 8 years, they were walking back and forth basically every other month, every third month, every fourth month, depending on what else was going on. And that was part of the constant activity they were involved with. Also, we know that Washington had most of his winter encampments here in New Jersey. Everybody knows about Valley Forge, which was in Pennsylvania, and we know that there was, most people know there was one good winter encampment, I mean, good in the sense that it is well known, not that it was comfortable, at Morristown. But there were actually several encampments in Morristown, and also in Middlebrook, Chatham, and other areas of North Jersey. And the reason Washington had those winter encampments was because of the British in New York. What geographic feature is between Morristown area and the east coast of New Jersey? The Watchung Mountains. So Washington was basically strategically encamped behind the Watchung Mountains, where he could keep an eye on what the British were doing in New York. Many of the battles that were fought here in this area, like Springfield and Connecticut Farm, Short Hills, etc., were because the British were coming over trying to get Washington to come out from behind the mountains and meet them on the field of battle in open, full-force combat, because the British thought they could eliminate him that way. And Washington was constantly trying to avoid that full combat. He wanted to preserve his army for the long haul, and he was able to do that. So that's one reason why a lot of stuff was going on in New Jersey. All of those soldiers in Morristown needed food during the winter. And there's not enough food around Morristown itself to feed them all. It's going to come from all over the state. And who's going to bring it to them? Militiamen, for the most part. Who's going to give up their family food for the guys of Morristown? A lot of the militiamen. That's just a representation of the Watch on the Mountains. Now, the British also sent part of their army from New York. They kind of split it in half and sent half of it to Philadelphia in the summer of 1777. And it was there for a full year until June of 1778, just before the Battle of the Mine. So for a year, New Jersey was surrounded. And again, what do those guys in Philadelphia need? Food. Yes, they can go out into the countryside of Pennsylvania and get food, but they're also going to come across the Delaware River and get food from South Jersey. And so the militia from any part of the state could be called to South Jersey in order to counteract those forage raids. So there's a threat both in the east and in the west for a good portion of the war. Now, of course, the British decide then to leave Philadelphia. They march across New Jersey, and while they're marching, the militia is harassing them. The militia played a great role in making life very, very uncomfortable for the British and Hessian soldiers marching across New Jersey. It was almost as bad as the heat. It was horrible, horrible heat that they were marching across New Jersey in also. But the militia really just kept right on them. They're just like attached to them almost. And then Washington, of course, brings his Continentals, encounters at Monmouth something of a stalemate. Both sides like to claim they won, but the British left the field and went back to New York and evacuated New Jersey. This doesn't mean the war is over in New Jersey, because now they're back in New York. You got that same problem you had at the beginning. Also, we have to remember in New Jersey, there was a civil war going on. It wasn't just the Americans against the British. It was American against American. It was loyalist versus patriot. And it was large numbers of both. And it got ugly. It got very ugly. And so a lot of those skirmishes that I talked about taking place in New Jersey were skirmishes between militiamen and between loyalist groups that didn't necessarily call themselves militia, but they were kind of the equivalent of that. The Patriots, of course, called them gangs of thugs, but they considered themselves to be equivalent of the militia. Okay, that gives you just a brief introduction to the nature of the war in New Jersey. And now I'd like to talk about the militia a little bit and give you an idea how it was organized, how it fit in with the Continentals, and take a look at some of the misunderstandings that people have about the militia. When I was doing my research, this was one of the things that really stood out for me. I thought I knew some things about the Revolution from studying it ever since I was a kid, and I thought I knew what the militia was. One of my Revolutionary War ancestors was a New Hampshire militiaman, and I looked at his life, so I thought I knew something about it. But I found that there were a lot of misunderstandings that I had, And as I've given talks like this, I find that that's not unusual at all. One of the key misunderstandings is that militiamen, being part-time soldiers, only had to turn out, only had to go on active duty when there was danger to their home community. I think you already can tell from what I've said to this point that that is a misconception. They might go anywhere in the state. Technically, they weren't supposed to be sent out of state, but even that happened on occasion. Some were sent to New York State for a while. At one point, some were sent into Pennsylvania for a while. But it took special legislation, practically, to allow them to go out of state. But they could go anywhere within the state. Militiamen had many more roles than just combat. We often think of the militia as fighting alongside the Continentals, or fighting instead of the Continentals if they were off somewhere else, but in kind of an open battleground situation, equivalent to what the professional soldiers did. And point of fact, that didn't happen very often. It happened occasionally, but by far the other things the militia were asked to do were what was making them harassed and exhausted. They were the local authority, the police authority, if you will, for the Patriot government. The government that took over from the colonial government of New Jersey and established the state of New Jersey after the Declaration of Independence. It was just one of 13 states that were joined together in a loose confederation under the Continental Congress. The Continental soldiers were basically under the authority of the Continental Congress, could be sent anywhere in the 13 states. But the militia was a state organization, and it became the protector of the state. This is one reason why I got so involved with loyalist combat. And to control the Tories, or the loyalists, very often the militia were called out by the governor or by the state legislature to arrest people who were known to not be dedicated to the cause of the revolution. They might disarm them, they might bring them to prison, they might bring them before the state legislature, and the state legislature would question them and ask them to swear an oath of loyalty to the new government and to forswear their allegiance to Great Britain. And depending on how they conducted themselves, they might go free, they might have to put up a bond, they might be put on parole, you know, or they make a statement that they will be good and not do anything to oppose the revolution, or they might be put in jail. They might also be told, pack your family up and go to New York, and like the British so much, go with them. Okay? Get out of town. And by the way, when you're out of town, we're going to confiscate your property and sell it to help promote our cause. The governor and the legislature, because there were so many loyalists and loyalist groups who were armed and were organized, they needed protection. So militia were called out regularly to be essentially bodyguards for the governor and guards for the legislature. By the way, the legislature during the revolution and the governor were located in Trenton during most of the revolution. Trenton was not the capital. You know, New Jersey had two capitals back then, Perth Amboy and Burlington. It was back to East and West Jersey, back to the colonial period. Trenton was just the county seat of Hunterdon County. But its location was vital and very strategic. And both Burlington and Amboy were close to British armies. Perth Amboy is right across from Staten Island area, those guys that are there. And Burlington, particularly when the British were in Philadelphia, you know, that's not a good place for them to be. They want to be far away. So they were attracted. So a lot of these guys from all over the state might get assigned to spend some time in Trenton guarding the governor or the legislature. As I said, they could defend anywhere in the state, not just their local area. And we pretty much talked about these things, so I won't repeat them. That just kind of summarizes it. But then they also had to assist the Continental Army. The Continental Army was seen as the front line, the main force, the group that's really going to be active, but they did need assistance at times. They needed information. And again, a lot of these Continentals are from other states. They're not from New Jersey. They don't know the local people. They don't know who to ask. They don't know who's going to tell them, you know, what's right and what's wrong, that sort of thing. So the local militia certainly did know everybody. And they could get good intelligence for Washington or whatever. Particularly, I mentioned the march across New Jersey towards Monmouth. The militia was not only harassing the British, but they were sending information back to Washington all the time, letting them know where the British were, how fast they were moving, what was going on, so that Washington could make his plans. Messages needed to be carried. You know, they had no cell phones. They had no electronic ways of getting messages out. Communication is difficult back then. It's basically a man on a horse carrying a letter from one man to another. And again, who knows the territory? Who knows the best way to get from one place to another? The militia. So they would get called on for that. The army needed to be guided in New Jersey. We're so used to the road signs and all the directional facilities that we have, we forget that, you know, back in the 1770s and 80s, it was dirt farm roads, and the main roads weren't a whole lot different. And knowing what road to take, what turn to make, at what point, very, very difficult. Imagine the night before the Battle of Trenton, when you cross the Delaware River at Conkey's Ferry, and you got to go 9 miles down to Trenton in the middle of a blizzard, in the middle of the night, and everything looks the same. How do we get there? You have New Jersey militiamen guiding you along the way. When there were battles in New Jersey, like Monmouth, like Springfield, the militia was called on to play a more typical or a more traditional military role alongside the Continentals. And they did, and generally did pretty well. The one place that you don't find a lot of New Jersey militia in a battle is the Battle of Trenton. And that's because for the Battle of Trenton, Washington was going to cross from several different places in Pennsylvania over to New Jersey. But crossing at McConkey's Ferry, that everybody knows about, the one where he stood up in the boat, flag is going and everything, that hadn't been created yet. That was just one place. That was the only place that got across, the only place where the soldiers got across. The other places where they were staged to go across, the ice was so bad they couldn't get across. And the New Jersey militia was stationed at one of those points. So the New Jersey militia never really got involved in the Battle of Trenton, except for about 20 guys who were guides on that overnight march that I just mentioned. They were local guys. Now, supplying the army. This could be another whole lecture as to how the army got supplied. The one word that I would use to describe the system for supply was it didn't work very well. It was a mess. They were constantly trying to improve and constantly trying to make it work, and it never really worked to satisfaction. But one of the things that they wound up having to do, particularly right here in New Jersey, was to impress, you know what impressment means from the War of 1812, Navy ships and that kind of thing. Only this is on land. They needed to impress farmers and their wagons and their horses in order to take supplies to the army. Now, impressment didn't mean the guy didn't get paid. Theoretically, he got paid. Of course, even the soldiers weren't getting paid half the time. So a lot of these guys didn't either. But, you know, they might get impressed for a week, for 2 weeks, for a month, you know, whatever was happening. It often happened in the winter to take supplies to those winter encampments, but it was really all year long. It got actually to be a very delicate thing for the militiamen. I'm going to be talking about the law in a minute, and a militiaman who did not turn out when called for service, which was usually a month. If he didn't turn out, he could be fined. He had to pay a fine. Well, if he gets impressed to go carry supplies to Morristown, Trenton, say, and it's the same couple of weeks that he gets called out to go guard against the British at Staten Island, and he doesn't show up, his captain fines him. Well, he's doing service for the military, but he's still getting fined for not doing the other job. Now, everybody's sitting here and say, well, I know how to fix that problem. You just don't fine guys that are doing the other job. Common sense. You know, things were just as bad then as they are now. It took a legislative act. It took a lot of guys having a problem before the situation could get resolved. And finally, the New Jersey State Legislature did exempt men while they were doing wagon service on the militia duty. But anyway, I want you to see, this is a lot of stuff that we don't normally think about militia doing. We think about militia being involved in battles. But it wasn't always that. Now, how did this affect the families? Militia duty was unpredictable. The one thing I will say, just ahead of myself a little bit here, is militia duty was required. It was not voluntary. When you signed into a militia unit, obeying the law and doing it. It was like signing up for the draft, essentially. That kind of thing. Everybody had to do it. If you got called out for duty, you didn't know when it was going to be. You didn't know, you couldn't plan ahead for how long it was going to be, where it was going to be, any of those things. And who are these militiamen? They're farmers for the most part. They're craftsmen. There are people who are keeping the New Jersey economy going. And yet they can't plan their own businesses. They don't know when they're going to get called away or how long the time. Made life very difficult. Now, one of the things that they tried to do to help the militiamen, militia companies were geographically formed. It was all friends and neighbors and relatives and in-laws and people you'd grown up and spent your whole life with. It was not strange. Everybody knew everybody. Some families had more than one man in the militia. Militia age was 16 to 50, required age. When a boy turned 16, he was automatically required to be in the militia until age 50. A guy over 50 could volunteer for the militia. And a few boys managed to get in before they were 16 by not being completely honest about their age. But again, that was hard because everybody knew. Yeah, but of course, they didn't have so many good birth records and things like that back then, so there was a little bit of play with that. But what they would do is they would divide the company into several groups, and it varied during the war. Sometimes it was two groups, three groups, four. But say it was two groups. So let's say there's a father in his 40s who has a son in his 20s. Both of them are of militia age, and they have a farm.
since they divided into two groups, I'll put the father in one group and the son in a different group. That way, if they call out one group, they're still leaving a man at home to take care of the farm. Not two men, you know, may be needed for the work, but at least one man. They may have men who are neighbors, live next, you know, have farms next to each other. One man in one group, the other man in another group, so that they can trade off work when the other guy's away. So, even if you weren't away on active duty, if you were home, your neighbor might be away, and you might need to be helping with that work. Not unusual for people to help each other out at this time, by the way. You know, when the farmer got sick, the community would help him. If he had a horse go lame, the community would help him. You know, they were used to this kind of thing. But it does create more work. And when it's happening as often as it does with the militia, it gets to be a real burden. Now, women often wound up having to take care of their husband's business, be it a farm or be it a craft shop or whatever, when the husband was away on duty. She didn't know how long she was going to have to be taking care of the house and the business. And all these issues to deal with. She also had to send her husband off with some food. Militia was supposed to get fed by the government, by the county, really. And that only was good for when they got to where they were supposed to be on duty. So the guys leaving Trenton didn't get food until they got to Woodbridge or Perth Amboy or Elizabethtown. So it was like 3 days of their walk, they had to supply their own food. By the way, their month of duty didn't start until they got to their post either. Some wives were interviewed after the war and said, yeah, you got called out for a month. Yeah, right, it was 5 weeks. Because you got to count the travel time that he was away from home, even though it wasn't all military duty. They had to take care of the man's clothing. We're going to talk about uniforms in a minute, and you'll see that why the wives had a real issue with clothing. You normally think of, you know, the Continentals and all that, you know, were supplied with clothing, although that was always questionable as to how good that system worked. But for the militiamen, it was their clothing that they were wearing. And their wives had to make it, take care of it, prepare it, etc. And these poor women back home are wondering, when the heck is my husband going to come back? If he got called out for a month, there's no reason he couldn't get extended a second month, and I won't even know about it because they can't tell me. He might come home 2 weeks early because things change somewhere. I just have no idea. And I also don't know what condition he's going to come home in. Even if he doesn't go into combat, even if he only is out on guard-type duty, he's going to places that have guards all the time, that are constantly occupied. And you know that any place that's constantly occupied, you have cleanliness issues, you have disease issues, all of those kinds of things can crop up. The militia had almost as much disease problem as the Continentals did. Militiamen got wounded. They got injured. You guys know, being in the military, you know, there's all kind of opportunities for getting physical wounds. Some of these guys shot themselves in the hand, cleaning their gun, cleaning their musket. One of them got crippled for life because he was leaving the house where he was billeted in, I believe it was Woodbridge. And a guy behind him discharged his musket in the house accidentally, and the round ricocheted all over the room, finally ricocheted off the door jamb and went into the guy's heel and crippled him for life. The guy who shot himself in the hand is a real story. The guy was a tailor. He ruined his ability to earn a living. So, and these guys, in both those cases, they never had any contact with the enemy on that month that they were out. never knew what condition they were going to come back in. But very often, they're going to need some kind of nursing, pretty much a disease being primary. Now, why did the militia law place a disproportionate burden on the women? I think we've seen now, you know, why it was, you know, harassed and exhausted, okay? But why this disproportionate burden? I think it's, first of all, just very quickly, talk about the militia itself. When the war started, you know, the militia was very highly regarded when the war broke out. What were the first actions of the war? Lexington, Concord, Bunker Hill, they're all militia on the American side. The idea was, and the belief was, that if the Americans would just demonstrate, if the American men would demonstrate their willingness to serve in the militia and stand up to the British, Parliament will back off and rescind the laws that are taking away the liberties that we felt were ours as good Englishmen. Didn't work that way. So the question became, can we get a professional army, which we don't want to have, or are we going to stay with an amateur army, which is what we would prefer to have? How many men can we have in our army? You know, this is a question that I'll always often think about, but if you're involved in a war, you've also got an economy going. You've also got, you know, everything else that's quote, normal, unquote, going on in the country that needs to be taken care of. How many men can be removed from that to be engaged in the war? If we're going to have a professional army, we have to identify that number, then we have to try to recruit men or draft men or however we're going to do it to get that body together. If we're going to use an amateur part-time, are we going to require everybody to serve in the militia, or are we going to make militia duty voluntary? If we make it mandatory, how many men can we call out in any one month, and how often can we call them out in order to get done what needs to be done, but also keep the economy going? This is what New Jersey struggled with throughout the war. That the answer to how we can take on our enemy, which was not a part-time force, it was a full-time professional force. I hope everybody understands that the British Army was an all-volunteer army. The British did not draft anybody, they did not impress anybody into the army. They impressed into the Navy, but not into the army. Strictly volunteers. It was occupation for men. Something they did as a career, as a private or as an officer. So, if we're going to go against those guys who are experienced professionals, but are amateurs, it's probably not going to work too well. So, our second answer is we're going to have a professional army also, full-time army. And we're going to supplement it with militia. We're going to take militia away from the primary job and take it to the secondary. As the war went on, we came up with a third answer, a final answer, with a full-time professional army plus an allied professional army, the French. And we kept a militia. The militia was always there. Now, every state, all 13 states, had a militia system, and they were all a little different. So everything I'm telling you now is about the New Jersey system. Keep that in mind. Okay. I don't know of any other state that was exactly like New Jersey.
Lower New York was.
Sorry?
Lower New York was. Lower New York State. that because they were so close together and worked back and forth over their cousins' farms and lands, they remained basically the same.
I'll accept that. I don't know that for sure, but I accept your, because I've looked at it. But, okay, that'd be great, yeah. One of the things that we have to remember about New Jersey is that they had a militia from the 1660s. When New York, or excuse me, when Great Britain took over New Amsterdam from the Dutch and created New York, one of the first laws that was passed was a militia law. The militia in the colonial period was organized as a defense force for your community. It was considered a civic responsibility being a citizen of your community, which you would be in the militia. Which means you were required to own a gun, a military weapon. You were required to own ammunition. You were required to own all the accoutrements that would be required in combat. You did not have to have a uniform, but you had to have all the equipment. You had to be willing to train a certain number of days a year. You had to agree to be called out and that sort of thing. Through the colonial period, those laws were hardly ever enforced. Colonial New Jersey militia hardly did anything. It just never had to. It was never an issue. Unfortunately, that's going to be the mindset when the revolution starts. You're going to think, oh, this is going to be just like the colonial militia. The militia was organized by counties. Each county would take a group of townships within the county, organize them into a regiment, and then within each township, neighborhoods would form into companies. The regiment that I looked at was, this is Hunterdon County during the war. It had four regiments. It had the most of any county in New Jersey. And the first Hunterdon was made up of men from the communities of what are now Trenton, Ewing, Lawrence, and Hopewell Townships, which are now in Mercer County, not in Hunter. We think of the militia as being amateurs, but many of the men were experienced either from the French and Indian War, even though the militia didn't do much during the French and Indian War, men from New Jersey did join what were known as provincial regiments, which were American groups that fought with the British Army. And many people had experience with that and could bring it back. Also, as the war progressed, the revolution progressed, men spent time in the Continental Forces and then came out and went back in the militia. If a man signed up for a year in the Continentals, as they did in 1775, they were basically 1 year enlisted. His year was up, if he didn't re-up into the Continentals, he was automatically in his local militia company for the rest of the war, or until he went back in the Continentals. You didn't get credit, you know, for a year of full-time service. You went right back to your part-time service. So not all of them were amateurs by any means. Every man was supposed to, by law, own all these things. That's a leftover from the colonial period. We know for sure that not every man did. We know that people were fined because they didn't have this piece of equipment or that piece of equipment. We know that men had to share muskets, each of those groups. Man in one group sharing a musket with a man in the other group. Think of all the 8 years of war, the wear and tear on muskets. You know, if a guy has to buy his own, it's a major expense back then. So we know that there were many times that a number of the militiamen who turned out, who said, yeah, I'll turn out, I'll do my job, but they came without a rifle, without a musket. It's not some way to use them. Uniforms, not required. Like I said, there was never any of the militia laws that required uniforms. And in fact, when you think about the purpose of the militia as being kind of like the last gasp home guards, they're not going out on the field of battle where they have to be identified, you know, by their uniform. They're, you know, fighting from behind houses or whatever, you know, in their local community. So they normally didn't think about uniforms. However, because they were called out so much and were acting so much like professional soldiers, some of the men might have their wife make a more military-style outfit for them to wear on militia duty. Some of them had hunting shirts made, and a lot of the Continentals were wearing hunting shirts, the rifleman's shirt, and so some of them did that. Some of the men were more wealthy than others. The men who were in the cavalry units, and the other men that I'll just tie in with it, is not everybody was an infantryman. There was artillery and there was cavalry in the militia. The artillery guys obviously didn't own the cannon, that was owned by the county, and they just served it. They were volunteers for that. They could volunteer for the artillery. Nobody was required to be in the artillery. A lot of the young guys liked it. This will be cool. So I never had trouble getting people for it. The cavalry, the light horse, the guy had to be a little wealthier because he had to supply his own horse. He had to supply all his equipment for the horse as well as his own personal equipment. So they were, you know, a little upper. And they, because they had a little more money, a little more esprit de corps and that kind of thing, we know that some of them either had leather helmets made or some kind of uniformity kind of set them apart. But mostly, and even that they did that, they were responsible for the cost of their uniform and their families. I mentioned that it wasn't voluntary. But being on the list didn't mean you actually went out on active duty. There were many holes in the militia law. And just like during the colonial period, the militia law was not enforced all that great during the revolution. There were some men exempted. If you were a leather worker and you were spending a month making saddles for the Continental Dragoons, you might be exempt from militia duty for a month. If you were involved in a very important job, say, working in an iron foundry, making cannonballs and cannon barrels and that kind of thing, you might be exempt all the time with one qualification. You were still on the militia list. You still had to be armed and keep it at home and all that kind of thing, but you only would be called out on the original militia idea if the fight was in your hometown. You didn't have to leave town, like the other guys. That was the only exception. You could pay a fine, but fines could be appealed. And there's many, many instances of men appealing fines and having the fine take back. They could only appeal after they paid the fine. And sometimes it took 6 months, 8 months, a year, but there's a lot of paperwork showing a lot of them got their money back. They convinced people that they were a hardship case that month and they shouldn't have been required to go out. The court or the review committee wasn't do that. You could also get a substitute. Substitutes are a very interesting idea. Those of you that are interested in the Civil War and some other wars, substitutes were involved. Put all that aside and think a little differently here. The substitute was not a permanent thing. If I get called out, let's say I'm a farmer and I get called out in June when I need to be doing some plowing, or May when I need to be doing some plowing, and I just say, I can't leave now. But my son, I can spare. I'll send my son out this month instead of me. Or a blacksmith who has an apprentice. I've got so much work I gotta do, so many jobs here. I can't go out this month. I'm gonna send Joe my apprentice out, just for a month. So it wasn't a permanent thing to do a substitute. It might also be that some guy comes through town, you know, an itinerant laborer, he's looking for a job, and the guy says, maybe I'll pay him to do my militia duty this month, and then I can do my work. So you see, it's a different idea. The guy might not consistently have a substitute for himself. It would be situational rather than permanent. And so that's basically the story. We know the nature of the war made the people harassed and exhausted, and we know the law made it so that a lot of people could avoid it and put a disproportionate burden on those willing to serve. Thank you for your attention. If you have questions.
Question. Perth Amboy was the capital. Where was Governor Franklin operating out of? The Tory governor, the royal governor.
Well, he was operating out of Connecticut. I believe it was June of 1776, which is about a month before the Declaration of Independence. He was arrested by the New Jersey Militia, General Hurd. Daniel Hurd, who was from the Elizabeth County area, took a group of militiamen, and it was very peaceful arrest. Not a violent thing, but they wanted to get him out of New Jersey, and recommended, and they took him to Connecticut. Now, before that, and when he was acting as governor, they kept switching off periodically between Amboy and Burlington, where the colonial legislature would meet the government. Okay.
Yes.
Yeah.
Larry, I'm going to keep answering questions, but I just want to thank you for coming.
Oh, you're very welcome.
And I hope you have a splendid trip back.
Thank you.
And I hope we can press you to come and join us again. And you want to listen, you want to get the vigilant and decide from the tent.
Yeah.
Maybe we'll get Bill Ahern back and you can come see Bill and Bill Gorman.
Thank you very much. Question?
A third didn't care, and then the other third was before the revolution. So what did they do about the other people? Did they chase them out of the state or something and took their property and all that?
Did everybody hear the question? I'll repeat it. The common belief is that the citizens were divided basically into three groups. A third who supported the revolution, a third who were loyalists, and a third who didn't care. And I was asked to kind of comment on that and how the Patriots dealt with those other two groups. First of all, I personally would not use those percentages. Okay? Those percentages originated in a statement by John Adams. And he was kind of just talking frivolously about what it might have been. And it's kind of carried on from there. I think it changed frequently what the percentages were. One thing that we have to understand today is they were living in their present. They didn't know how it was going to turn out. They didn't know what tomorrow was going to bring. They also had a lot of pressure from friends and neighbors and relatives, family, and many people who, had a strong feeling one way or another, and other people who had a lesser strong feeling, and it was constantly sliding along a continuum as to how much they supported the revolution or didn't support the revolution. I can tell you that one thing that really changed the numbers was the Declaration of Independence. Before the Declaration of Independence, there were a number of men who you would look at their life and say they were diehard patriots. They were officers in the militia. they were supplying, they were paying for weapons for the militia, supplying ammunition. They were recruiting people for the Patriot Militia. You know, they were just hosting people for the revolution. Then when the Declaration of Independence was signed, we said, can't do that. I can protest. I cannot leave Great Britain. They believed that the best way to get their freedoms back was to do it through the political system that Great Britain had. Do it legally, if you will. Okay? And they had confidence that that could happen, it could be done. That enough members of Parliament would understand the colonists' point of view and the Parliament would change. And they would not break away from England. And they, many of them became officers and enlisted men in loyalist forces after the Declaration of Independence, even though they've been officers in the Patriot forces before the Declaration. That was a major step. And it wasn't just, you know, fear of treason and that kind of thing. It was really a philosophical thing. You know, before the Declaration of Independence, most of the documents that you look at from communities in New Jersey, as the war is approaching, people petitioned the colonial government to try to straighten things out with England. And in every one of those cases, they start out by expressing their loyalty to England and their belief that England was the best country in the world, had the best government in the world. And that what is happening in Parliament was destroying that, those concepts and those values that they believe make Great Britain the strong place that they love from all of us. They were very strong in their opinions about no taxation without representation and the other issues, but they were very strongly loyal to Great Britain. The Declaration of Independence then forced anybody who hadn't already decided that independence is the only way to protect ourselves. Then they had to decide, is it better to stay with Britain and hope that things will change, or stay with the Patriots and really fight for something new? And hopefully it'll be better. There was no guarantee. They knew nothing about a constitution. They knew nothing about the form of government that they were going to be living under after the revolution. They just lived from day to day. So that's what I mean. As people kept thinking about these things, you know, they would change their opinions as to what they supported.
How did the British Army do regard militias vis-a-vis continentals?
Well, there's so many different situations that that's why I'm struggling with it here. One thing that I would say is that they didn't respect either Continentals or militia as anything other than rebels. Okay. Having said that, at least the Continentals, most of the time, or some of the time, were wearing uniforms and were acting like professional soldiers. Before the Battle of Trenton, earlier in December, 2 or 3 weeks before the Battle of Trenton, General Howe actually made a proclamation in his general orders to his troops that said, if you take any group of men out of, that are not in uniform, but are carrying guns and are shooting at us or at loyalists, we'll hang them instantly as criminals. They're not soldiers because they're not wearing uniforms. I don't know that they ever did that, but
yes,
he did make that proclamation. He didn't quite understand that these guys, these militiamen, were following a government. Not the British recognized, obviously, but we're following a government
and were part of a legal organization, not just a bunch of they had trouble with it. Does that answer the question, Chuck?
How much power did King George III really have? I mean, the Parliament, was it similar to what they have now, or was it?
Yeah, that's a great question. And for everybody in the period, the relationship between the King and Parliament, and where the power really was, the power was really with Parliament. And you know, when I was saying before the Declaration of Independence, and all these petitions were talking about their loyalty, they were primarily talking about loyalty to the king. They were looking to the king to get Parliament in order, to be on their side and fight with them to get Parliament to do the right thing. And when King George kind of refused to do that, then the Declaration, that convinced people the Declaration of Independence. So Parliament really has the power, more power than getting to the point. I don't know if it was exactly the point we're at today, where the Queen has virtually no power, but it was certainly in that direction. Yeah.
Has New Jersey ever repealed its militia law?
Great question, and I don't know. I know that the militia law continued after the Revolution, and militia duty was still required. New Jersey Militia served in 1793, putting down the Whiskey Rebellion. Some of the guys from the regiment that I studied in went out there to put that down, and it was still a requirement. I don't know if they ever did it afterwards. I mean, it doesn't. There's certainly no law in effect today.
In effect or ignored?
It might be there, but it's not being, it's like somebody, you ever read some of these books about laws that are on the books, whatever. If it's there, it's a message. But I think it's probably been, it either expired and was not renewed, which is probably more likely because the militia laws normally have to be renewed. But the whole idea of militia really gradually went away because we went to a professional army. When George Washington, one of the last things that George Washington did in 1783, he wrote a program, if you will, for how the country should be defended. Full independence, and it was a militia system. It was not a communist system. They basically dissolved the colonial army except for 1 or 2 thousand men out on the frontier, and went with the militia. But it was a very different militia from what I described here. Very
different. Yeah, real fast.
One last question.
No, real. I got just a comment. In the late 1960s, when I was at Montclair State College, we had the, what's the highest title for a National Guard commander in New Jersey? Adjutant General?
General.
Yeah, he came to Montclair State, was during the anti-Vietnam stuff, and he riled off the students to no end when he told them that under New Jersey law, he still had the right to call muster days, and called people out on the green for military training. So it might still be there somewhere.
It is there. Yes, it's from 1776, and it just keeps rolling forward, very modestly. And it was called the State Guard after everything was done and said after the Spanish-American War. And then you get the State Guard all stirred up when Pancho Villa is running around New Mexico and Texas, killing everybody, swiping everything. So the president said, that's it, everybody's going to Texas and New Mexico to serve under Pershing. And they scooped up everybody from New York, Pennsylvania, Maine, Massachusetts. The only guys that didn't go were the guys from Ohio who owned the airplanes who got put for sale in Oklahoma. And then they went to Texas. And they didn't have to worry about flying because there was so much sand, their engines wouldn't work. But when the State Guard was finished, they brought it back. But as they brought it back, it was denationalized. World War I comes around, they call it all up again. The first troops to go are all the National Guard units from the Hudson River all the way past the Mississippi. And they're nationalized and they're put into camps. And all their gear is taken away and they're refurbished and they're trained and on the boats they go and they go overseas. 90% of what served in World War I started out as State Guard that became National Guard that all got shot up to hell over there. And the flu epidemic, very few came back.
So National Guard is really the
replacement for the
descendant of the militia. But the National Guard, as you know, is not the same.
No, it's not the same, but the law is. That the president has the right to call.
All right. Okay, thank you
very much. Yeah, we're right.